between biophysical environment and socio-cultural environment. Understandably, anti-reductionist and anti-geographical determinism or biophysical determinism led by sociologists to neglect biophysical in favor of socio-cultural. So the second step was to reject the biophysical and think in terms of socio-cultural. Thus, each time, and that's the point, a conceptual distinction was made among potential causal explanations of human behavior. Anti-reductionism and anti-determinism prodded sociologists to reject or ignore the lower set of variables, lower in their cognition, first biological and then physical, to focus on the emergent class of social variables. So if you look at the universe, to which I'll come after a while, it is differentiated in terms of mainly three: the physical, the biological, and the social culture. And we, unfortunately, focused, we sociologists, focused only on the social culture. The second major tradition, which has contributed to sociology's neglect of physical environment, may be located in the works of Max Weber and his followers. This tradition emphasized the importance of understanding the ways in which people, that is social actors, define their situations to explain their actions. The assumption here is the reality of a situation is in the definition attached to it by the participatory actors. So we, the participants in the system, would give meaning to action. It is the meaning of social action which is important. And this meaning is given by us to the social situation, which implied that the physical properties of the situation may be ignored. Physical properties became relevant only if they are perceived and defined as relevant by the actors, the process through which these physical factors became social facts. We can define a physical fact as a social fact. I don't have the time to go into it, but just to give you one example, take national flag. It's a physical fact entity, but why are we showing so much of respect? Because we are changing that into a social fact. So it's quite possible to argue that insofar as a physical fact is dismissed as a physical fact and is not given the importance of a social fact, or insofar as it is not symbolized as a social fact, we sociologists used to ignore it. Let me summarize what I've said so far. The Durkheimian legacy suggests that the physical environment should be ignored. The Weberian legacy suggested that it could be ignored, as it was unimportant in social life. Should one violate the traditions and suggest that physical environment is relevant to understand human behavior or social organization, one risks being stigmatized as an environmental determinist. And that is the reason why I said environment, the presence of environment in sociology is very rickety. Now all determinants are castigated. We dismiss the Marxian theory as economic determinism. It's not taken seriously because of that. I'm not saying it is correct or incorrect. All that I'm trying to say is whenever an explanation is extended in terms of a determinism, be it economic, be it psychological, be it environmental, it stands to be castigated. Now, why is it that it happened? Please remember that sociology was a latecomer as compared with history, geography, economics, and politics, and it needed to create a special province for itself, the socio-cultural sphere, to claim legitimacy and autonomy. Why is it that a particular discipline, here it is sociology, be recognized? If only it has its own autonomy as a discipline, and if only it has to make a contribution, that is the basis on which legitimacy of a discipline is created. Therefore, the initial anxieties of the discipline were understandable, but not acceptable as it developed. The point I am making is that in our effort to understand environmental sociology or environment in sociology, we must recognize that regardless of theoretical orientations, whether it is functionalism, whether it is Marxism or interactionism, sociologists treated human societies as if they were exempt from ecological and environmental constraints and influences. That is the reason why environment has a very rickety position in our discipline. Personally, most sociologists have totally ignored the biophysical environment. If so, how come environmental concerns crystallized in sociology? To understand this, we need to probe into the origins of our discipline. Again, I'm not going into much theory because this is not the occasion for that. But let me tell you one or two. I'll refer to one or two authors. Agnes Heller, a famous name, but I don't know how many of you are familiar with it, insists that, and I quote, "Sociology is the offspring of modernity, and it bears the birthmark of a modern parentage." And Ernest Gellner, another well-known authority, again a quote, "In the 20th century, the essence of man," please don't call me an MCP, and you know what is MCP? I'm reading out the quotation. "Essence of man," which includes certainly woman, "is not that he is rational or a political or a sinful or a thinking animal, but he is an industrial animal." So in the 20th century, human beings have become industrial animals. This is in contrast to social anthropology. And in India, we mix up the two. I'll come to that in a moment. And Kathleen Gow, again a very famous name, told us anthropology is a child of imperialism or colonialism. Now this Western controversy need not detain us here, but I only want to point out that in the West there was a clear distinction between sociology and social anthropology, and as far as sociology is concerned, insofar as it was a study of industrial modern societies, the possibility of developing interest in environment was greater. That's the point. In fact, I have written a whole book on this. It is called Knowledge and Society, Situating Sociology and Social Anthropology, which probably is not prescribed for you, and I hope probably it is proscribed. Because what book we teach depends on who wrote the book. Well, some of these things are dealt with there. What is pertinent for the present theme is to note that modern industrial society of West started experiencing urban decay, pollution, population density in cities, resource shortages, etc. So the discipline had a liability as a problem to explain some of the things because of the founding fathers, I already told you. But then society did not wait for them. The urban industrial society emerged in the West and it threw up new problems. And by mid-1970s, the three national sociological associations of the United States of America, namely American Sociological Association, Rural Sociological Society of America, and Society for the Study of Social Problems, had instituted organizational units devoted to environmental sociology. So they created organizational mechanisms to study environmental sociology. You may be sometimes wondering why I have taken the example of the United States of America, not because I'm fond of American Americans, but because that is where your subject is most prosperous. But yet, and this is more important, the two leading journals published from America, United States of America, namely American Sociological Review and the American Journal of Sociology, did not publish a single research paper concerning environmental problems from 1970 to 1990. Now, try to think about it. I know you have come for a different kind of a lecture. I could see your face, you're all very upset. But I'm asked to talk about environment in sociology. And that's why I'm emphasizing it. Even in the Mecca of sociology and sociologists, between 1970 and 1990, not a single article on environmental sociology was published. Of course, in the last 25 years, there is a limited awareness and it is emerging. And then think of the world body of sociologists, the International Sociological Association, ISA. It started with, and of course the association was there, and then it had what is called research committees and the working groups. The importance of a subdiscipline or an area is usually discerned in terms of the recognition given to that sub-team, family or stratification or whatever. There are 44 research committees in ISA. And it had only a working group, that is the lowest level, the working group on environmental sociology. But it had a research committee on social ecology. And what they did was in 1992, which is very recent, they have merged the two, the working group on environmental sociology and the research committee on social ecology in 1992. Now, ISA has a research committee on environment and society in existence for the last 25 years or so. I hope now you will endorse my statement made at the outset that environment has a rickety presence in sociology, although the emerging trends are promising, to which I'll come in a moment. How about the situation in India? And again, I'm pretty sure. Have you read any book by a man called Radha Kamal Mukherjee? Very unlikely. You are undergraduate students, even in postgraduate departments. His books are not prescribed. I have not studied as an MBA student, or even as a PhD, because my subject was different, as a PhD scholar. Any book by Radha Kamal Mukherjee, but I was invited to give what is called the memorial lecture of Radha Kamal Mukherjee Memorial Lecture by Indian Sociological Society a few years ago. And when I started looking at, I found a very interesting, I discovered something very interesting. And this paper, this lecture is actually published in a Sociological Bulletin, which is the official organ of the Indian Sociological Society, in January, April 2015. Now, I've already told you, at the world level, at the global level, the presence of environment and ecology is very rickety. But now I'm going to tell you the good news as far as India is concerned. Radha Kamal Mukherjee lived for 79 years. He was born in 1889. He was trained as an economist, but in his book, Regional Sociology, published in 1926, he defined human ecology, and I quote, as a systematic study of plant, animal, and human communities which are systems of correlated working parts in the organization of the region. He was writing about regional sociology. And he was trying to suggest that plants, animals, and human beings are into which I'll come in a moment. How about the situation in India? And again, I'm pretty sure. Have you read any book by a man called Radha Kamal Mukherjee? Very unlikely. You are undergraduate students, even in postgraduate departments. His books are not prescribed. I have not studied as an MBA student, or even as a PhD, because my subject was different. As a PhD scholar, any book by Radhakumar Mukherjee, but I was invited to give what is called the memorial lecture of Radhakumar Mukherjee memorial lecture by Indian Sociological Society a few years ago. And when I started looking at, I found a very interesting, I discovered something very interesting. And this paper, this lecture is actually published in a Sociological Bulletin, which is the official organ of the Indian Sociological Society, in January, April 2015. Now, I've already told you, at the world level, at the global level, the presence of environment and ecology is very rickety. But now I'm going to tell you the good news as far as India is concerned. Radhakumar Mukherjee lived for 79 years. He was born in 1889. He was trained as an economist, but in his book, Regional Sociology, published in 1926, he defined human ecology, and I quote, as a systematic study of plant, animal, and human communities which are systems of correlated working parts in the organization of the region. He was writing about regional sociology. And he was trying to suggest that plants, animals, and human beings are interrelated. In 1938, he published The Regional Balance of Man and Ecological Theory of Population. In 1940, Man and His Habitation, a study in social ecology, was published. And in 1945, a study in social ecology was published. A study in social ecology, published in 1945. This is considered to be his magnum opus. He has worked on several areas. But it's very unfortunate that Indian sociology and sociologists are completely neglected. But that is another theme. According to James Quinn, an American sociologist, Mukherjee may be credited with having the first constructive, systematic, theoretical book on social ecology. This is by an American sociologist, written in 1956. In the same year, another American sociologist compared Radhakumar Mukherjee to Tucker Parsons. I'm sure you all know Tucker Parsons' name, but not Radhakumar Mukherjee. See the paradox in which we are living. And he wrote, his name is Manuel Gottlieb, it is precisely in the area of social ecology, an area in which Mukherjee has helped to bring into prominence as a special branch of sociology, that Parsons' work was most deficient. He was comparing Tucker Parsons, who was the uncrowned king of American sociology for a couple of decades. And all of you would know at least the name, although you may not always spell his name correctly, Parsons. But he was comparing Parsons with Radhakumar Mukherjee and said that Radhakumar Mukherjee has an edge over Parsons because of the importance that he has given to social ecology in his writings. What I'm trying to suggest is that, although ecology or environment was subject to what may be called a cognitive blackout in sociology the world over, Radhakumar Mukherjee has recognized it as an important theme of investigation. And yet, environment or ecology remained as one of the most neglected areas in Indian sociology. Why? Again, to understand this, one has to dissect the trajectory of Indian sociology itself, which is far beyond the scope of the present lecture, but as I already indicated to you, I've written a whole book on that in order to show how is it that Indian sociology moved in certain directions and not in certain other directions? Suffice it to say that the relevance of the theme of ecology or environment dawned on social scientists only after witnessing ecological devastation and environmental degradation. Mukherjee recognized the importance of ecology much before the rapid economic development brought about through a rash application of high technology came into being some 90 years ago. But the kind of sociology taught in India resulted in ignoring environment or ecology. We were actually, we in India, through Mukherjee, were pioneers in the study of environment and ecology. But the sociologists, as a whole, did not take cognizance of it. As compared with that, let's say G.S. Gurie, all of you will know. Emil Srinivas, all of you would know. But Mukherjee was completely ignored. And that is where the politics of knowledge come. This is not the forum to talk about it, but that's a fact. In spite of the pioneering efforts of Mukherjee, environment or ecology remains grossly neglected in Indian sociology. I refer to American Sociological Review and American Journal of Sociology. Now I refer to Sociological Bulletin, the official organ of the Indian Sociological Society, published over 700 papers between 1952, the year in which it started, and 2011, when it got 60 years of age and the jubilee was celebrated. But the bulletin published only 8 papers out of 700 on ecology or environment. And there is a book edited by Ramchandra Guha, who is not a sociologist or a social anthropologist. He calls himself a historian. And that book is called Social Ecology, published in 1994. And most of the contributors are non-sociologists.